years old. Original Nova Galactic construction is my guess. Built to stand the test of time.
I wonder why this place was abandoned in such haste.
Nova Galactic Project Log, Principal Engineer Lang Shu. I admit, this is not the most disciplined team I've ever run. Malcolm keeps stealing computational time on Voltaire and thinks I don't know this. And Sabina's been distracted lately, but won't tell anyone why. I really should demand answers from both of them. But honestly, I'm too preoccupied with this contract. We all are. Despite anything going on in our personal lives, there's something special about what we're building here.
Shipyard? Building the actual vessels that are gonna travel the stars?
We're literally on a base on the moon.
Oh, come on, Sabina. I'm trying to share my dreams here.
Well, your dreams are always out there and never here where the rest of us live. Can't you just be happy doing your job?
Where's the fun in that?
When you have a few moments, there's something I'd like to discuss.
Okay, confession time. Being single on a moon base is the worst. I only get like an hour to use the communication link to Earth every couple of days. And let me tell you, there's long distance dating, and then there's like long distance dating, you know? Oh, hey there, I'm a scientist, deadly employed, willing to take you out for coffee in like 6 months when I'm back from space. It's not a great opening line.
You seriously can't get a date? You're an astronaut!
Hey, no one asked you! supercomputer so powerful, they put it on the damn moon to keep it cool. Although by that logic, they should be running it purely in the vacuum of space. But hey, good marketing material. I've been spending some off hours running some dumb simulations, just because I can. My favorite so far is simulating the sound of every duck on Earth quacking after receiving a piece of bread. You didn't know you wanted a real-time sim of feeding all the ducks, but now you have it. You're welcome, humanity.
Nova Galactic Project Log, Principal Engineer Lang Shu. Voltaire is being reconfigured for this new initiative. The math we're being asked to crunch is ambitious, even for a supercomputer. We might as well be asking it to count every grain of sand in every desert on Earth. Who came up with these original equations? Our partner isn't being very open about it. Every question I have goes through some discretionary channel. I'm surprised we even know we're working on a ship.
Why are you bothering? We should have a talk. When you have the time, of course.
When I accepted the assignment up here, we were told to bring a couple of personal items. Some psychological study said it helped when you're away from Earth this long. I brought my grandmother's old abacus. I would play with it on her lap, and she'd teach me the Russian for all the numbers. She got word that she passed. The next shuttle isn't for 3 months, so I won't be able to go to the funeral. Goodbye, Babushka. Thank you for teaching me math. It brought me to the moon.
Engine spin-up time almost complete. Total time, 5 minutes, 22 seconds. Ride on schedule.
How are the helium 3 valves holding, Nova?
We double-checked the leakage concerns this morning before the launch. All signs of...
Any changes to the calculation sequence from Voltaire?
No changes since we uploaded the last figures yesterday. It's a clean shot from here to Jupiter.
One day the computer will be on board the spaceship. Just imagine that.
One miracle of science at a time, Canaveral. Counting down in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Canaveral, are you reading?
All clear, Nova. Indicators look good. The ship should be cruising Jupiter's orbit right now. Visual confirmation will be possible in 32 minutes. Afraid the speed of light is on the slow side these days.
How does it feel to break the laws of physics, Canaveral?
We're all pretty excited down here in NASA, I won't lie.
Excited enough to tell me where you got the original data?
Not in a million years.
Ever since we talked about the Battle of Cassiopeia, I can't get what happened out of my mind. Was it that obvious? Oh, I thought I could handle these memories, but until I return to Cassiopeia, I'll never be able to put this to rest. The last time I saw my crew, their escape shuttle was headed for the planet's surface. I need to find the wreckage to ensure their memories are honored. I would like that. Actually, I need that. One problem, though. Pinpointing the crew's shuttle wreckage is going to be like trying to find a grain of salt in a sandbox. I think we need to start by locating my old campsite on Cassiopeia 1. The Dauntless took heavy fire to the docking section during the battle. We had 3 shuttles. One was destroyed, and the other 2 were damaged. There was no other way off the ship. Shortly after I evacuated, I saw the ship come apart. The UC listed it as lost, so I assume the Dauntless was completely destroyed. Was there to tell? I survived. My crew didn't. Still, I'll never forget my finger hovering over that launch button. Would I launch safely or explode into a fireball? It turned out that my shuttle had just enough power to allow an emergency landing on the planet's surface. I wouldn't call what I did a soft landing, but thank you all the same. It has a breathable atmosphere, indigenous fauna, and maybe a few abandoned mining outposts. Otherwise, it's not populated. My shuttle should have the telemetry tracking data for the other shuttle aboard. It should give us an idea where it went down. That's if scavengers haven't completely stripped my ship for parts. Hold on. I don't know the exact location of my survival campsite. For that, we are going to have to head to Mast and see if we can get the information from my old friend, Admiral Logan. Your instincts are right on target. Logan and I butted heads more than once during my time with the Navigator Corps. We've never seen eye to eye. Look, I hope this isn't asking too much. Last thing I want to do is drag you into some kind of personal crusade. That's why I'm desperate for your help. Truth is, I'm scared. When I set foot on Cassiopeia, I don't know if I'll be able to handle what I find. If I begin to fall apart, I need someone I can trust to hold me together. I know you will. You've always been there when I've needed your help. Why you continue to support me, I'll never understand. I don't know what to say. I've been so busy searching the stars for answers, I've overlooked what's been in front of me all this time. True love. Something I've seriously considered sharing with you for a long time. I'm just not ready. Not yet. Yes. Yes, you're absolutely right. Hey, anyway, I've taken up enough of your time. I know you have a lot to do. I really appreciate your offer to visit Cassiopeia. Hopefully, it'll bring me the closure that I've needed for far too long. If you don't mind, I'd like to have something for me. Warm up the engines. Unless I'm mistaken, that's one of the launch towers used during the evacuation of the Earth. I can't even imagine the chaos. Would be via an elevator shaft taking us straight down. Hopefully the system is still in operation. Search for a way to restore the power and get it back into operation. Never hurt anyone, right? was in loading position. I wonder what prevented this particular colony ship from lifting off. Looks like it was some type of crew preparation area. Probably the last step before boarding. It's definitely seen better days.
Judith Tatien. The recent delivery from Mars is unsettling. I was expecting rock samples or maybe fossils of microbial life. Instead, Dr. Victor Isa comes with two members of the military. Everything they've brought back is under wraps. What could a theoretical physicist need with a sample from Mars? Station log. Dr. Judith Tatien. I've been trying to cozy up to Dr. Isa, Victor, to see what is going on. His team has completely commandeered one of the labs with those two military handrails, checking who comes in and out. I joked that maybe he found a little gray man and was doing an autopsy, and he grew very pale. 2 days later, he sends me a request asking for more information on my background in material science, metallurgical engineering. Oh, we have a meeting tomorrow. I think I'm being invited into the lab. Station log. Dr. Judith Tatien. I have never been so nervous since I defended my dissertation. 4 hours talking to Victor and his team about theoretical metals, atomic bonding, even a half hour divergence into magnetism that I'm pretty sure was just to throw me off the trail of what we were actually talking about. Then I got to see the lab. I don't know how much I should say, but the periodic table just got thrown out the window.
Some of the artifacts here are from the earliest years of NASA. Oh, what a shame all of this was left behind to deteriorate.
conditions came from.
There's something wrong with the math? I think it's quite straightforward.
That's not what I'm asking. We've had no success extracting even a sample of material from the object. No explanation for the gravitational effects, no motion graph to explain its harmonic frequencies. I can't even establish a melting point.
Judith.
But you've had me building these prototype colliders for months. And now you want me to bump helium 3 into it based on this equation you've written on a goddamn napkin?
I just need you to trust me.
I have been trusting you. We keep slamming our heads against a brick wall, getting nothing. And you keep coming up with something new to try. Like, you know what's going to happen. Where are you getting your information, Victor?
I'm sorry, Judith. Look, not here, okay? Somewhere off base. I'll tell you everything. But I'm not lying, okay? We're going to discover something important here. I promise.
Left of this geology laboratory. Ironically, the surrounding rock appears to have sealed the fate of this part of the facility. Thank you. that rubbish already.
Thank you.
It appears we've found one of Vasco's long-lost relatives. I'm sure he'll be thrilled to find out.
Project Log. Dr. Victor Issa. We turned on the prototype today. The gravitational field around it began to fold as we long suspected. Complete reversal of gravitational pull was observed on dozens of loose objects around the lab. I'm setting up a meeting with the directors to propose a larger test. The prototype proves we don't need the original anymore, but further work is going to have to take place in space. Somewhere with abundant helium-3 and with a civilian partner. Someone with access to large-scale manufacturing resources and computational equipment. Engineering gravitational folds pulling the far side of the solar system closer to us? It's all going to be possible.
Project Log, Dr. Judith Tetzian. I watched the GravJet tests from the moon today. It was the first time we were able to talk to the team at Nova Galactic directly. So many things were under wraps before, but now everyone wants all the publicity they can get. I'm already seeing proposals for manufacturing androids of drives, expeditions to Alpha Centauri and beyond. It's also overwhelming and worrying. It could take years. Decades before we know what all these side effects of operating a grav drive can be, but no one wants to hear that right now. Like a bunch of pioneers racing towards the edges of the frontier without knowing about the grizzly bears in the mountains.
Since I traveled with Vladimir Sol. Thank you. Behind.
I never actually got to visit your labs back when we were working on the grav drive projects.
Seems like ancient history now. Only thing we're doing these days is launching weather satellites.
Guess this is as good a retirement as any. Now, Project Demeter, you want our help manufacturing scanners to better track these new meteorological patterns we're seeing.
Our guess is that the poles might be naturally shifting, causing some gravitational fluctuations that are throwing off our old models.
Why do you need the scanning tolerances to be so small? What are you trying to find?
Want to be sure. It's not like we're doing much these days anyway. The glory days are over. Why not give ourselves a challenge before they write us off in the history books?
I know what I'm seeing, Victor. The data coming back from the satellites is very clear. It's the grav drives.
All those jumps from the moon. At this rate, Earth's atmosphere is going to start sputtering out into space.
Can the drives be fixed?
I'm working on some designs that should discreetly solve the problem, under the guise of an emergency update to the fueling pumps.
We're talking about the end of Earth, and you're trying to be subtle about it.
Judith, the last thing we need is people losing faith in grab drive technology. That might be our only option.
To what? Are you seriously saying we should abandon Earth?
The timeline is under 50 years. A blink of an eye for a planet, but more than enough time for a human exodus.
And what do we tell people?
We say it's an act of God, one that science has found a solution for. Time for humanity to take its place in the stars.
You knew, didn't you? You lied to me. All this time, I dedicated my life to this discovery, Victor. And you knew we were going to kill off our planet?
You haven't seen the future I've seen. There's an infinite expanse of promise out there. A meteor could hit Earth. A plague, another world war. Colonizing other galaxies secures humanity's future for all coming generations, across all time.
At the expense of our home!
Stop it, both of you! All that matters is building enough ships to get everyone off this planet. And we need to start now.
I'll draft up a statement. We'll need to address the entire international community. Sorry, Judith.
There isn't a planet in this universe that will be far enough away from you, Victor. We are never speaking again after this is over.
My name is Dr. Victor Issa. And if you're listening to this, then you probably already know the truth. I was young when I first headed the retrieval team of an odd gravitational anomaly on Mars. But I kept what really happened that day hidden from everyone except one other person. Even she didn't believe me at first. But I have no reason to lie to anyone now, so I hope you'll accept this confession, whoever you are. When I touched the anomaly, I experienced 12 days of lost time. I met myself. He told me everything that has since come true. The grav drive equations, the tests on the moon, Earth's atmosphere sputtering away because of what we had done. But he also told me about a city thriving on a planet orbiting a distant star. Human culture, art, music, lifestyles evolving and shining brightly across all of space. What price would I be willing to pay for that future? Maybe you don't believe me. Maybe Judith was right and I'm just a coward who wants to believe his mistakes were justified. But everyone has forgotten about the real origins of the grav drive. This artifact from Mars. I hope you make better use of it than I did.
Oh my God! The grav drives destroyed Earth. And at the core of the first drive, an artifact.
And it looks like other Starborn got here before us. So, you might have company.
I don't even need a gun.
That's it. Time to sell some of your junk. Thank you.
for nothing. Nothing!
Understand now why I asked you to come here. The artifacts unlocked the secret of interstellar travel at the cost of Earth.
An easy trade, honestly. Why have one world when you can have all the settled systems?
Every grav drive in the settled systems was built on technology that came from an artifact that was discovered on Mars. But these early drives shook the gravity field surrounding Earth. Eventually, the atmosphere started to slowly sputter away into space. That is why Earth is uninhabitable. The artifact gave the scientists a greater understanding of time and space, but not the wisdom to see where that would lead.
The settled systems wouldn't exist without the artifacts, in other words. We owe what happened here in NASA a great debt.
Don't you see? The power of the artifact forced humanity to the stars. They didn't get to make a choice. How many would have chosen Earth? What gave Victor Issa the right to choose for them?
You see the hypocrisy in what the Emissary is saying, right? They don't want to rob people of their free will, but then they steal the artifacts for themselves.
In the wrong hands, the power of the artifacts can make anyone a tyrant. That is why we watch over them. The only thing you're watching out for is yourself.
emissary and I may have our differences, but you do not want to give us a common enemy.
For once, he is right. Don't do this. We can collect the final pieces together.
Well, look at that. The emissary just became my new best friend.
You've made your choice. When you're ready, the Hunter and I will be at the buried temple. That's where we'll settle things.
Meaning, we'll kill you. But hey, at least we'll wait. The final round doesn't start until there's only one artifact left to gather. And if I'm not mistaken, Constellation has one or two to go.